230 is not this huge deviation from common law that it's often painted as.
Welcome to the Washington Tech Policy Podcast.
The latest tech law and policy news and brightest tech law and policy experts wherever you are.
So you can stay informed on the move in less time.
From Washington, D.C., it's the Washington Tech Policy Podcast.
With Joe Miller.
Joe Miller.
Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg maintains his company's policy to leave up false statements in ads placed by politicians, for now. But Twitter has banned all political ads, and Zuck's set to meet with civil rights leaders who oppose the policy this week. Will he change his mind? And Brent Scorup is my guest. Hey, everybody. Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg is set to meet with civil rights leaders this week after his company has maintained its policy to leave up political ads containing false statements by politicians. The company has applied the policy unevenly, first allowing Donald Trump to maliciously post an ad with false information about Joe Biden, then leaving up an ad Elizabeth Warren placed containing false information designed to illustrate the absurdity of Facebook's ad policy. During a hearing, Zuckerberg also admitted to Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez that if she were to place a false political ad, that the company would probably leave it up. But Facebook is inexplicably removing false ads placed by political action committees. One notable example is an ad placed by the really online lefty league, Roll, a political action committee co-founded by Adriel Hampton, which falsely claimed that Lindsey Graham supports the New Green Deal. Hampton, an experienced marketing and political strategist, responded by filing to run for governor in California. Then gubernatorial candidate Hampton posted a false political ad and Facebook took it down, saying his campaign wasn't legit, that it was just a ploy to place a false ad to see what Facebook would do. Even though Hampton says he fully expects to win the governorship, Facebook hasn't reinstated the ad. It's a mess. Top officials from the NAACP, National Urban League, and the Leadership Conference on Civil Rights are scheduled to meet with Zuckerberg this week to express their concerns with Facebook's political ad policy, which the company now says has been extended to the UK. A plaintiff in San Francisco filed a potential class action federal lawsuit last week, claiming that Facebook discriminates against users based on age and gender in determining who can see financial services ads. The lawsuit comes 7 months after Facebook agreed to tailor its platform to avoid discrimination on the basis of age, gender, and zip code for job, credit, and housing ads. The Committee on Foreign Investment in the United States, CFIUS, has launched a national security investigation into TikTok, which is owned by the Chinese firm ByteDance. A bipartisan cohort of lawmakers, including Democrat Chuck Schumer, Republican Marco Rubio, and Tennessee Democratic Congressman Bart Gordon, have all expressed concern about how the Chinese government uses TikTok's data. TikTok's growth has been outpacing the growth of incumbent social media companies in the U.S. Whistleblower Edward Snowden, who was exiled in Russia for blowing the lid off the National Security Agency's mass data collection practices 6 years ago, told Recode's Kara Swisher last week that Facebook is as untrustworthy as the NSA when it comes to privacy. But he didn't limit his remarks to Facebook. He said that all tech companies are looking to exploit our personal data no matter the consequences. He also said that on the surface, users may appear not to be concerned about how big tech companies handle their data, but that in reality, users are very concerned but feel powerless. Five people were shot and killed at an Airbnb rental in Northern California during a Halloween party on Thursday. The rental listing on Airbnb prohibited parties, and the renter claimed it was renting the space for family members who were suffering from smoke inhalation from the fires in the Los Angeles area. A witness reported to BuzzFeed that the shooting occurred with apparently no provocation. Airbnb has banned the renter from its platform. Chinese officials announced last week that it would roll out 5G to Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou, and Hangzhou 2 months ahead of schedule. The country also announced plans to roll out 5G to over 50 cities by the end of this year. While U.S. telecom companies have begun their 5G rollout, it's largely been rolled out on higher frequency bands than the 5G service that's being rolled out in China. The lower frequency bands that China is using cover a larger surface area, while the higher frequency bands U.S. companies are using are more powerful but cover less ground. Senator Cory Booker has introduced a bill to ban facial recognition in public housing. The senator cites the disproportionate impact that facial recognition technology threatens to have on the nation's most vulnerable communities. The No Biometric Barriers to Housing Act targets public housing that receives funding from the Department of Housing and Urban Development. Apple announced that it will invest $2.5 billion to address California's affordable housing shortage. Some of those funds will be applied statewide. Others will be allocated for projects in the Bay Area. $300 million will go towards affordable housing on Apple-owned property. 35 Democrats in Congress sent a letter to the House Judiciary Committee to pass a federal revenge porn law that would criminalize the non-consensual posting of sexually explicit images online. The letter followed Congresswoman Katie Hill's resignation from Congress after someone posted nude images depicting her and others, as well as accusations that she was having inappropriate relations with campaign and congressional staffers. Hill blames her husband, whom she's in the process of divorcing, for posting the photos. Finally, Massachusetts Institute of Technology President Raphael Reif acknowledged last week that women and people of color often face exclusion and belittlement on campus, and that it's something the university is trying to improve. The development follows revelations of Jeffrey Epstein's ties to the university. And you can find links to all these stories in the show notes. Stay with us.
You're plugged into the Washing Tech Policy Podcast, the inclusive voice of tech policy.
My guest today is Brent Skorup, Senior Research Fellow at the Mercatus Center at George Mason University. His research areas include transportation technology, telecommunications, aviation, and wireless policy. Brent has a BA in economics from Wheaton College and a law degree from the George Mason University School of Law, where he was an articles editor for the Civil Rights Law Journal. He was a legal clerk at the FCC's Wireless Telecommunications Bureau and at the Energy and Commerce Committee in the U.S. House of Representatives. Before joining Mercatus, he was the director of research at the Information Economy Project, a law and economics university research center. Please welcome Brent Skorup. Brent, thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
So Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act says that internet platforms, from social media giants to individual bloggers, can't be held liable for content posted by third parties. And while internet companies want to maintain the Section 230 shield, others are arguing for its repeal, claiming that it allows big tech companies to escape liability for things like hate speech. But a white paper that you and Jennifer Huddleston published back in July says that even without Section 230, internet platforms would still be able to avoid liability for third-party content. Tell us what you mean.
So Jennifer and I, we started writing this paper about 2 years ago. We saw these debates about the internet and internet liability and controversies over big tech companies starting to bubble up. And so we looked at the Section 230 law, which, as you said, gives some immunity to tech companies, big and small, when they publish or republish content from other parties. And what we found, it was somewhat surprising to us, when you look at the history of publisher liability law, you see earlier precedents for Section 230. You see, for instance, that broadcasters and newspapers and magazines were starting to get receive more liability protection from courts via the common law system, and in some case via state statute. And the, you know, our paper in a nutshell says Section 230 is not this huge deviation from common law that it's often painted as. There's actually some precedent for treating media distributors in this way.
And so in your paper, you and Jennifer argue that the movement away from publisher liability has its roots in the development of the law of negligence in the 19th century and a 1933 case called Lane versus Tribune. Tell us about your analysis there.
Yeah, so in traditional common law, say 150 years ago, there wasn't really a negligence standard in tort cases, and for media that was generally defamation or libel of people. The old rule, the traditional rule, was strict liability. If you republished something defamatory, a publisher was liable just as if they had spoken it in the first place. But starting about a century ago, courts started creating negligence rules. Basically, you had to be at fault before a court could find you liable, before a party could get damages from you for defamation or libel. And you saw this negligence standard start to work its way into defamation cases and media cases. And we look at the Lane case, as you mentioned. This was a 1933 case in the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, and this was a party brought a defamation case against a newspaper who had republished a story from, I believe, the Associated Press, a wire service. So the journalists hadn't written the story, they just republished what was from the newswire. And the publisher, the newspaper, was sued for publishing the defamatory content. And the court said in that case they created what's been known as the wire service defense, which is basically a newspaper or a publisher is not liable for what they pull from a wire service or the Associated Press. And for us, that jump started this move in a big way towards protecting publishers and newspapers and the media. And that's largely because of the wire service just made it much easier to distribute news to a much larger audience. And your journalist, your editor at a local paper can't investigate, you know, these tricky legal questions about defamation in every case that comes over the wire.
And so then what happened after Lane?
So Lane has kind of jump-started this negligence standard. You had to be at fault. They couldn't just say you republished something defamatory and win awards. There had to be a fault requirement, is what the Lane case said. And this proved to be influential for other judges, other state courts, and broadcasting was just getting started in the 30s and 40s, and it became influential in those cases, and the broadcast industry got laws passed at the state level that created negligence standards, so they wouldn't be strictly liable if someone said something defamatory on the air. There was a case in Pennsylvania, Summit Hotel, where this was in the 1940s, I believe, no, 1930s. A guest on a radio program said something defamatory about a hotel, and a similar case as Lane. The court said, you've got to show some fault with the broadcasters, and so you started to see this course required more than strict liability. They required negligence, and the protection for media started in the 1930s and grew from there.
So what are the First Amendment aspects to this?
Yeah, in our paper, we say there are two reasons why courts started protecting media distributors, traditional media publishers, from liability. One was the practicality arguments I suggested, which you can't have editors and broadcasters poring over all news stories or all guests on a news program and figuring out if what they're saying is legal or not. That's a practical argument on the First Amendment, but courts also cite First Amendment concerns for holding broadcasters or newspapers or magazines liable for content, which is things like defamation and other types of torts for publication. They're not always easy to identify. I mean, in some cases they are, but they're not always easy to identify. In the broadcast case, it was a news guest saying the hotel was a rotten hotel. And is that defamation? That's a really fact-dependent inquiry. And so courts also started recognizing what came to be known as the wire service defense and later the conduit defense, which is generally speaking, they're not liable for what they republish, and certainly not unless you can show fault on behalf of the publishers. And that was for the practical arguments, but also for First Amendment arguments, that if they are liable, media companies are either not going to publish something or they'll be taking down what has been published at a high rate just to avoid litigation and lawsuits.
So other than the First Amendment, Brent, how do we get from tort law to what we have in Section 230?
So Section 230 is aimed at the internet company. Interactive Computer Services is the term used in the law. And so there were these earlier precedents, and they're almost always about defamation. There were a few copyright cases, but with the internet and defamation is a tort. With the internet, it's the issues are broader than just torts. So Section 230 is anticipates these debates that we have today about broader than torts, things like hate speech and pornography and adult content and product authentication for eBay or Amazon. So it's somewhat broader than the cases that were prior, but that's largely because the internet is just a different technology than say broadcast TV or cable TV.
And the courts have applied Section 230 very broadly.
Yeah, that's right.
So what are some examples of that?
So there's a few cases that come to mind. There was a Zirin case. It was, I believe, in the late 90s. There was some bad actor online posed as a man named Ken Zirin and was selling this really tasteless T-shirts and things with tasteless slogans about the Oklahoma City bombing. And this man, Ken Zirin, who was being impersonated, was receiving all kinds of phone calls and unwanted attention. And Zirin sued, I believe it was some media company that was online that had this prankster's content on there. And the court said, sorry, Mr. Zirin, essentially, sorry, Mr. Zirin, you can't sue a web provider for just posting what someone else posted. You've got to find the person who posted it. These online media distributors, they're protected by Section 230. So it's fairly broad. And another example I mentioned that we mentioned in the paper is product authentication. So there was a lawsuit. Someone purchased something from eBay. I believe it was a cheap knockoff. It was not an authentic as it was advertised. And they sued, I believe it was eBay, a marketplace, online marketplace. And the court again said, Section 230 provides protection if they're just simply making available what other people are posting, they can't be liable for that.
And what are some exceptions? Are there, what are the contexts where the courts have been willing to hold platforms liable despite Section 230?
Well, there are a few things. One, Section 230 does have some carve-outs, things like obscenity, child abuse, things that are violate federal law. Also, copyright violations are another example. These are carved out from Section 230, so online providers can be liable if they host content or republish content like that. And there was a case called the roommates.com case. It involved it was matching roommates together, and the website added some drop down menus about, I believe it was the sex of the roommate you had a preference for, male or female, and some other things. And that the court found it violated federal housing laws. And the provider was liable in that case because they were providing the problematic material. In this case, the sex of roommates, when it's the online provider providing content like that, they can be liable despite 230.
So based on all of this common law and then the way 230 is developed and the way it's been applied, how do you respond when opponents of Section 230 say that it gives internet platforms quote-unquote special treatment?
So our paper suggests that it's not quite that special. Section 230 is not the special treatment it's often painted as. And frankly, this surprised Jennifer and I. This was not... We didn't know this history. I think most legal scholars would be surprised by this history, that you see courts giving broader liability protection to traditional media, like cable operators, like satellite operators, like magazines. And so, our paper suggests Section 230 is not the special treatment it's often painted as, and in fact. There are two cases in the 90s about online platforms. One held that internet platforms were generally not liable for what they published, for what other people published and the online provider distributed. The other court case said they are liable, and that's where Section 230 was enacted. But courts were already saying that online providers look like traditional media and they should be protected, and despite making available what's from third-party users.
Well, thanks for this analysis, Brent.
Yeah, thank you.
So when we come back, we'll do an icebreaker, career advice, and hear about what you're reading and watching these days. Okay, so it's time for this week's icebreaker. What's a favorite charity that you wish more people knew about?
So mine is it's a local one. It's one my family's been involved with. It's a camp in northern Wisconsin called Camp Blessing. They have a camp every summer for adults with intellectual disabilities, my family's been involved as we've had members of our family as campers at the camp and also as volunteers working at the camp, and it's for a segment of the population, adults with intellectual disabilities, who are often invisible to most of us, but it's a great camp for them and I know for their families as well.
What's the best career advice you've ever received?
I can't remember who originally told it to me, but it was don't care about who gets the credit at work, and I think that's true. I think your coworkers, your bosses. Notice good work, no matter who gets the credit in the end, and it's worked well for me, and I think for others. Just do good work, and people will notice, no matter whose name is ultimately put on it.
Absolutely. What are you reading these days?
I like history. I like reading history books. So lately, one I really liked is called Danubia by Simon Winder. He's a UK journalist, but he writes in a very lively way about, in this case, Habsburg Europe and the history of the Balkans in the Habsburg times. I'm also reading Arthur Schlesinger's History of the New Deal, which I believe is a three-part series. But so Danubia and Arthur Schlesinger's History of the New Deal.
I met Arthur Schlesinger once at the New York Historical Society. He was standing. He did a panel with Henry Kissinger.
I bet that was great.
Yeah, I've been reading Frederick Douglass, the autobiography by David Blight.
I read his autobiography. Yeah, that was great too.
Well, thanks again, Brent, for joining me. Do you have any final ideas you'd like to leave with the audience before we close? And where can folks find you online?
Sure, they can find me on Twitter. My handle is bscorup, and you can also find my work. I work on technology policy and transportation policy and telecom policy, and that's available at mercatus.org.
And you've been listening to Brent Scorup, Senior Research Fellow at the Mercatus Center. Brent, thanks for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
Concludes episode 208 of the podcast. Thanks so much to all of you for listening. If you like what we do, we'd love to hear from you. Please take a moment, head over to Apple Podcasts, leave it a review. It helps others know what they can expect from the show and really helps us out. Thanks again to all of you for listening, and I'll see you back here next week. Take care.